Nehru Planetarium, Bengaluru. Jawaharlal Nehru Planetarium, Bengaluru, in association with ICTS, is bringing out this series called Coffee with Curiosity. And this program, what we call as Coffee with Curiosity, has produced wonderful lectures to the public, and it has brought down a very advanced science to a general public. So this has been a very great program and one of the flagship program in association with ICTS. So I welcome to today's coffee talk on the vortice of liquid crystals. As you may know that JNP conducts many science popularization programs here, including this series, as I mentioned, Coffee with Curiosity. So it is a pleasure to inform you that we have another popularization program this week, coming week, that is happening at this venue, that is called Science in Action. Science in Action program is science exhibits demonstration mainly to the school, high school children, and also general public. So this brings the physics concept, generally science concept, through the demonstration, through the experiments, and through the exhibits, so that it is another way of a very popular way of taking science to public. So if you are free, please come and visit on 18th, 19th, and 20th of August. So with this, I welcome Professor Rukmini to tell about the speakers today and also introduce the speaker. Thank you.
Hello, everyone. Welcome to Coffee with Curiosity. Hearty welcome to all of you. It's my great pleasure to introduce Professor Michel Mitov, who obtained his PhD in condensed matter physics from the University of Nice, France. He is the director of research at the CNRS, the French National Center for Scientific Research. His current interests include the design and optics of twisted liquid crystals, along with biomimetic versions inspired by insect Kara spaces. He is the inventor of patents for smart windows that manage solar light and temperature. He wrote an essay of science popularization called Sensitive Matter, Foam, Gels, Liquid Crystals and Other Miracles About Soft Matter. So, hearty welcome to you, Professor Michel.
Thank you very much.
Just before starting, we would like to hand over a token of appreciation to you.
Okay.
So I would invite Dr. Anand to hand over the...
Thank you very much. It's very kind for you. Thank you. Thank you very much. So good afternoon to everybody. I'm very happy to be in India. It's the first time I travel in India. I was invited the last week for a workshop devoted to soft matter science. And today I hope to speak under the auspices of Sarasvati. And I would like to thank for the invitation in Bangalore and to this Coffee with Curiosity, the project coordinator, Anupam Ghost, and Ranjini, who invited me for the workshop. And I would like first to dedicate this presentation to Jean-Claude Carrière, who passed away 2 years before. He was a French novelist and screenwriter. He got an honorary Oscar in 2014. And a few years ago, I had written a book, and Jean-Claude Carrière very kindly wrote a foreword to this book. But independently of that, he had a passion that he discovered lately, science and mainly physics and physicist. And he said the quest of physics and reality is the greatest intellectual adventure of the 20th century. But he had another passion, the most important passion, and his passion was India. He had written in French Mahabharat, a version for the theater, and he said that writing a play based on this mythological epic was the most difficult thing I've ever done in my life, and he did a great job to diffuse knowledge and what Mahabharat is in France. And he worked almost 40 times for a long stay in India, all the India, with his friend and collaborator Peter Brook. Peter Brook participated to the play. And he had written a very thick book, Dictionary in Love with India, a fantastic book, and I had them in the plane by coming to Bangalore. And he was really probably one of the best friends that you have, for you Indian people in France. So the Odyssey of Liquid Crystal, I will begin it with a feedback. On Tuesday, April 4, 1968, in New York, a movie premiere took place at the Love's Capitol Theater. 2001, A Space Odyssey, a movie by Stanley Kubrick. And a lot of inventions that are shown in this movie are prophetic for the modern viewer, because you can see innovated international space station, video phone communication, processed foods, supercomputers with nascent artificial intelligence, and the space shuttle in which there are flat screen displays which look like liquid crystal displays. So now we start from the Love's Capitol Theater, and let's walk along the 50th Street to the Rockefeller Plaza, the RCA Tower, and the 28th of May, 1968, press conference is given by RCA engineers and scientists. The Radio Corporation of America has announced that it has developed a new technology, liquid crystals, that could have a major effect on the electronics industry, according to the Chicago Tribune 2 days after. And the engineers, the RCA engineers, have brought prototypes of electronic watches with no mechanical part. And these electronic clocks present a screen for which the numbers light up or go out according to the time to be displayed. But there is more astonishing, because RCA promises soon the display of a moving image. So it's the beginning of a revolution in the field of displaying an information. It does not consist to improve the technology, but to create novel technology, and it is the birth of a new industry. So my talk today will narrate the story of a carrot, which starts his travel in Prague, Czechoslovakia, in Prague in 1888. And it is the story of a curious space-time travel until a flat-screen display in New York in 1968, when it crashed down on the screen. And the whole gallery of characters will appear in this story. I mean a surprised botanist, a mystical microscopist, a controversial zoologist, a vociferous physicochemist, a cigar-smoking chemist in the lab, a crucial chemist, a tenacious physicochemist, and a rigorous physicist. And the story begins in 1888 at the Institute of Plant Physiology at the German University of Prague. And Friedrich Renitzer is a botanist, a biochemist, to say it in modern terms. And he has a very interesting, but I would say modest research subject. He wants to extract cholesterol esters, crystals of cholesterol esters, in the root of a carrot, in order to know if these cholesterol esters behave like the cholesterol esters we know in other substances. But he made surprising observation. He's talking about two melting points for these crystals. Melting points, it is the temperature for which a crystal, when it has colors, lose color and rigidity. And he has noted that first the color is lost, and then as a superior, at a greater temperature, the rigidity, sorry, is lost first, and the color is lost at another temperature. And it is very surprising, and very quickly he write a 14-page long letter written in Gothic letters to a physicist, Otto Lehmann. He's a crystallograph and is a specialist in phase transition in crystals. And mainly he has built, it is the only scientist to have built at this moment, microscope with an intake stage, and with this intake stage is he able to follow the evolution of texture in a crystal by changing the temperature, by heating the sample, or by cooling it down. And this apparatus are very rare at this moment, and so Renitzer has said, I have to contact him. And he explained that so crystals lose their rigidity at the first temperature, they became like a milky fluid, and at the second temperature, they are like a transparent drop. And when the transition is in the other sense, when it is the sample is cooled down, first it presents a violet color, and by cooling, then a blue color, and finally it is still liquid, but it has a cloudy aspect. So these observations are very surprising. But Renitzer had the feeling that it is not an artifact. He knows that he has the control on the substances. He thinks that this is not polluted liquids or substances. So he decided to give interest to this phenomenon. And many letters and samples are exchanged in March and April between Renitzer and Lehmann. And Lehmann took control of operation from this moment. And at this moment, Renitzer is out of the subject. And they will reappear in the history of liquid crystal science 20 years after, because Lehmann wanted to rewrite the genesis of the events, and it claimed for priority. But in this paper, 20 years after, he will write the unambiguous concept of flowing crystals was recognized by Lehmann first of all. The perception is due to Lehmann, the credit of discovering the phenomenon ought to be attributed to me. We have to say that strange phenomena in substances and materials were reported prior to Renitzer. It's the case of Buffon in 1749, when he was studying some structures that wriggle in Pawnee, the rest with water. In fact, it was mixture between lecithin, natural lecithin, and water. Virchow in 1854, when he described colored effect in myelin. Mettenheimer, 3 years after, described the double refraction, the birefringent phenomenon in myelin. And also Planer in 1869 with color effect in cholesteric chloride, Rehman and Lobitsch, Lachinov. But all these scientists just describe the phenomenon. They don't understand what they were observing, but they report the observation in their paper without considering that these effects are the general effects, but probably particular effects due to special substances. And Renitzer has no problem with this observation. This observation I cited in his seminal paper published in 1888, but the credit of the discovery is given to him because this is him, himself, he has recognized in this observation really a novel phenomenon. But Lehmann himself is now alone to work on the subject, but he is embarrassed because we can see it with the Lehmann's terminology that he used to identify the strange chemicals. First, he talked about flowing crystal, then viscous liquid crystal, crystalline fluid, liquid crystals forming drop, and at the end, liquid crystals. So it is an oxymoron, like we say, because typically it is the association of two names, which one contradicts the other. But at the moment they made this observation, what is the matter vision in the scientific community at the juncture between the 19th and 20th centuries? So the theories of phase transition were just appearing, but mainly until the end of the 19th century, there were very intense debates in the community about the atomic nature of matter, which were raging. It means that the fact that matter is made of atoms or molecules is not accepted by all the community. No concept of crystalline structure. René Juste Haüy gave the idea of a periodic structure for crystal in 1784. His student Gabriel de la Fosse deduced the concept of unit cell in 1840, but we have to wait 1914 with Max von Laue, physics Nobel Prize for his discovery of the diffraction of X-rays by crystals, and 1 year after, Bragg, father and son, physics Nobel Prize for their services in the analysis of crystal structure by means of X-rays. So it means that at the moment Lehmann spoke about liquid crystal, the idea of the coexistence of crystallinity and the fluidity was considered as impossible in an heterogeneous substance. So first opposition, Tamman was the most vociferous opponent to Lehmann ideas, but not only to the personality also. And it was the mixture hypothesis, so Quink, Tamman, Wolf, Nernst. And from 1890 to 1905. So he said these compounds are in fact mixtures. The multiple melting points are in fact the reflect of the melting point, the melting points of the ingredients, like a liquid which would contain dispersed crystalline particles, and each particle would give a contribution to the melting point divided in several melting points. So, okay, but they have the right not to give another possibility of explanation, but clearly speaking, this explanation does not correspond at all to the observation at this moment. And when we take a sample, a volumic sample of a liquid crystal, it presents a turbid, milky state. Snow is not a good point because it seems that the solution is polluted by someone or other. But I will explain later why it presented in the volume this aspect. And Taman said, soft crystals do exist, without doubt. For my sake, floating ones may exist, but leaking ones, no. Even when he said that, we don't know what he means by soft crystals. So the hypothesis, first solid explanation, presents to the scientific is presented to the scientific community in 1819. It was clearly speaking against the mixture hypothesis because Gaterman synthesized the first liquid crystals, and he uses about the purity, the common rules that were used by Pierce. So he was sure he has described very properly in the paper the how he proceed to purify the substances, and he's sure of of his work, and the purity of compounds was an argument evidently against the hypothesis of poorly controlled mixture. So it's the first stone, I would say. But the Carnot blow came with Rudolf Schenck in 1905 during a Bunsen symposium in Germany. There was a confrontation, even it seems for some authors a physical confrontation between Schenck and Lehmann with Taman. And the moderator was Vantoff, the first Nobel Prize in chemistry. And he was ready to organize the meeting between the scientists to discuss, but Lehmann was opposed to that because he considered that it was not, he was not respected by Taman. So, but Rudolf Schenck was very interested in the story of liquid crystal, and he worked during the day independently of his PhD subject. He worked the night, and by chance, he didn't follow the advice of his supervisor, Jacob Vollard. Herr Schenck left his stupid staff. And he gave, during this meeting, the results he had. It was the unmistakable proof liquid crystal. This is a pure and single substance. And he showed results about the discontinuous behavior of density and viscosity at the clearing point. So from now, it is accepted that liquid crystals are pure substances. But the idea is not very clear in the mind of the people, because the name liquid crystal continue to disturb people. Second important step, liquid crystal molecules are elongated. Vorlander signed a paper with an essential conclusion: most substances giving rise to LC phases are made with rod-like molecules. And we have to note that 4 years before, he did not sign with his students, Meyer and Dahlen, the publication repeating Lehmann's findings. He said to them, no, okay, very nice work, publish under your name. He wanted to make a distance between the scientific community and him, between controversial attitude and himself. But to have to notice that after that, he's the only signature is Vorlander, when the thing has been accepted. Why did it take 20 years to recognize liquid crystal as states of matter? I hope that this question is interesting for you, because it took a long time. And it is probably the best important slide in my presentation. If I had the right to keep only one slide, I would keep this one, so try not to miss it. Maybe I have missed it, but not you. For most important point, this is a strong paradigm change which is asked to the scientist. And it, evidently, there is a high intellectual cost when there is so huge, strong paradigm change. I mean that the main idea, the main message of liquid crystal is that the classical three-state paradigm has to be shattered. The vision of matter is continuous vision. There are intermediate states, typically between solid and liquid, and we have to forget to put in separate boxes the different state and the gaseous state labs. And it was not possible at this moment for Pierce to reproduce the experiments of Lehmann in their own laboratories. And as you know, in science, when you describe your experiment, your conferences, and mainly with papers, you give all the details, and to accept your discovery is accepted if it is evidently reproduced with other equipment in other laboratories by other people, independent of you. And this was not possible because the microscope were just in Lehmann's lab. Maybe also the liquid crystal research stayed a long time in Germany. We will see until 1909. And the oxymoron, liquid crystals, did not justify to the discovery of new states. It's a very strange and mysterious name, but it was not a good service that he was given this name at the origin to give this name to these substances. And there was a Lehmann's excessive attachment to the concept of liquid crystals. It means that probably Lehmann underestimated the importance of the discovery and of its contribution. And errors that he committed in a few papers required several decades to be corrected. And Lehmann's personality also, it's a problem because he's described by some authors as having a dogmatic personality. It's not a good point when you want not to be pleasant, when you want to convince peers that I have a discovery. And other authors describe him possibly more spiritual than scientific. We will see why. And he is associated, it's a pity, with the highly divisive Haeckel. Haeckel was a zoologist whose view on the evolution was deeply controversial. He wrote a book named Crystal Souls, and he was convinced that the matter, even the inert matter, was endowed with a soul. And when he has heard about Lehmann's liquid crystals, he was sure that Lehmann had discovered the missing link between the dead and the living. And he was desperately seeking. But probably in the papers of Lehmann, we can find avant-garde idea that passed for crazy world to the community. And I've taken this paper written in French by Lehmann himself in 1909. And in this paper, he wrote that using molecular forces to build an artificial muscle motor through the transition between the liquid crystal state and the liquid disordered state. And for example, in this, so it's possible to provide a contractile force production in a minimal amount of time. And in this image, you have here a rubber of this elastomer film for two different temperatures. Below the temperature of the transition, this rubber at its length, and when the temperature is above the transition, the length is different, as you see here. So probably we can consider that they were possibly forerunners of the concept of liquid crystal states as necessary to life by representing a compromise between order and disorder in living matter, if we leave aside the non-scientific claims of the Boston scientists. And this, the fact that liquid crystal states are as necessary to life, I will end my conference with this second idea, is the second good idea of my talk. So I say it now in order you stay here. In 1909, liquid crystal leaves Germany, and the 16th of April of this year, Lehmann gave a conference. He was invited by a French scientist, say, oh, come in Paris and show your experiments. And he came at Sorbonne, and he gave a long seminar in front of scientists, but not only scientists, but also non-scientists who wanted to came in the room. It was an avant-garde idea, was able to listen to Lehmann, but listen to Lehmann came with photographs and so drawings, but also several microscopes, and people were invited to see by themselves the transition and the color effect, the texture of liquid crystal. So this conference is really a great success. I have found a new German newspaper who related this conference. Lehmann is acclaimed. He is now a quiet guy, and he has recognition. And this event has given rise to a birth of a French school with Charles Mauguin, François Grandjean, Georges Friedel. And in 1922, Friedel wrote the seminal paper, 100 pages long. The first classifications came for naming the different phases. And he vehemently criticized the term liquid crystal and advocated for mesomorphic states, but the term has been kept. There was no great success with this very technical term, mesomorphic states. Mesos, intermediate, morphos, shape. It was not really a great success, but the paper was very detailed. There was a very important discussion, and he gave names to the different structures of liquid crystal. Here I have mentioned the three basic structures, the nematic state with elongated molecules, so, and they have a mean orientational order, but a disorder in the position. So the association of order and disorder. There are a lot of carbon and hydrogen atoms inside, and also nitrogen and so on. But all my description here, this is the contents of atoms in this rod-like molecules, but my description will stay at the level of the elongated molecule, not chemical details. And it is the reason why we name liquid crystals as molecular materials, because the description of their arrangement is begins at the molecular level. It does not mean that the chemistry has no importance, but the description of the structure, because it has, of course, if you change only one atom in the chemical structure, you may have a completely not a novel structure, but the miscibility property of this compound with another one can be drastically changed. But okay, in that case, it looks like a school fish. And for the school fish, fishes should be molecules. School fish, no order in their position, but a mean orientational order. Second basic phase, smectic phase, smectos means soap in Greek. And okay, orientational order. Disorder for the position, but the here in that case the molecules are disposed in layers regularly, more or less regularly spaced. And the third structure, cholesteric liquid crystal, it was discovered as I have said in cholesterol esters extracted from the carrot. So the beginning starts with carrot, and the cholesteric comes from cholesterol. But at this time, we had only substances with cholesterol derivatives. But years after, actually, the molecules have no relation with cholesterol, but the term has been kept. But sometimes it is called chiral mimetic phase because, as Friedel said it very nicely, this is the nematic phase's special way of being, because it's a nematic with a twist, like in this three-dimensional printing. It is the cholesteric helix. Here, all the molecules are elongated rod-like molecules, have a mean direction. If I described a nematic state, so the structure is the same in the third direction, but here this is a cholesteric structure, and there is a twist in the direction perpendicular to the long axis of molecules. This is an interesting representation because it shows that you can have a twisted helix with no layer, because sometimes the cholesteric structure is presented with layers. This is just a facility for representation. But this is really, in synthetic materials and in biological materials like your body, I will end with this fact, it is completely continuous. It is completely continuous. And the practical uses of cholesteric liquid crystal, maybe you know them, due to the fact that the pitch is sensitive to the temperature and the pressure. If you, the reflected color, because they have the power to reflect it from from the white light, only one color of the rainbow in your direction, and it is correlated. It is due to the pitch of the helix. If I change the pitch, I change the color. But this medium, when it is fluid, is sensitive to temperature or pressure. So it means that when you change the color, the temperature, sorry, you change the color. For example, the example here of thermometers that you put here, maybe you have seen them. I have brought a sheet of this material with me. It will be possible to you to test it, and you are able to see the thermography of my hand. And evidently, we can build the materials with a precision of a currency of 0.1 degree C. And it's reversible, of course. And this is the example of it's a liquid crystal from my lab. With you see, so the pitch has been tuned by mixing different liquid crystals to have a green color. But probably here you see a blue color. I am right or not. It's just due to the angle, because the wavelength is strictly the product of the mean refraction index by the pitch at normal incidence. But you have the cosinus of an angle when the direction of the helix, because the helix is like the direction of the helix is like that, and it's the reason why you see the color is changing. Other application, it is polarizer free reflectivity screen, even of big size. It's an example in US of reflective displays. It's interesting because you don't need polarizer, in contrast with the liquid crystal screen. I am going to show how it functions. But polarizer absorbs 50% of the ambient light. So interesting, because you can have also very vivid colors. You can have also flexible display, like here from Kent State University, or a blackboard. You, with a fingernail, you write and you erase the message by applying an electric field to the board. And also smart windows. The story is to have a smart windows with a cholesterol substance, which does not reflect only one colors, but all the possible colors. And if you reflect the light in the room, this reflect is not present, and you don't need theoretically a cooling system. But if you have kept the possibility to switch the material with an electric field, the electric field has the power with special cholesterics to unwind the helix. If you have not the helix, the light is not reflected and your window is transparent. So you can play by subjecting the window to an electric field between two different states, broadband reflection or a transparent state. And you switch off the field, the mirror effect is gained again. Prototypes, these things. Cosmetology, it is the hugest market of liquid crystals in the world. This is not liquid crystal screen, because you need a very small quantity of liquid crystal, but for cosmetics, you need huge amount. And here, this is an example. It is for marketing, because the color, reflecting color, is very nice. And the product is sold more easier than if the color is not present at constant composition. I would say, briefly speaking, there is more important than a beautiful aspect, more important, different purpose to use liquid crystal for cosmetology. Cosmetology, the basic problem is to mix lipids with water. As you know, lipids don't like water. The crystallization of lipids in a cream is a nightmare for producer. And the fact that you adjust the composition of lipids and water in order they create a liquid crystal phase, it means that they have some order, not complete order, because it would not be possible to use a cream, but typically a smectic state. And the fact that you have an organization, it offers to the cosmetics a longer life. That means that you take two products, same chemical composition exactly. The first one is not in the liquid crystal state. The other one is in the liquid crystal state. It means that the conservation will be better in that case. And also anti-counterfeiting attacks, like for these banknotes, you see in the same case that my cell, that the 20 is the European banknote. Green 20 becomes blue 20 due to the angle effect. But also another, I have no time to speak about the polarization selectivity, but there is a unique property to cholesterics. The reason why, if you have not cholesteric ink to solidify on the banknote, with a simple polarizer, we can see that these banknotes are not true. And many other possibilities to manage light and energy, this time at the micrometer scale and nanoscale also. In 1913, the orientation of the molecular director by a solid surface was discovered by Mauguin. And 5 years after, the role in electric field and the orientation of the molecular director by his colleague Grandjean. In fact, two fundamental effects underlining forthcoming liquid crystal displayed in 1968, but at this time microelectronics was completely known for people. And Grandjean discovered this effect accidentally. At this time, this guy who worked on liquid crystal wanted completely clean surfaces. Nowadays, we will take very special equipment, white rooms, to prepare very clean surfaces. But in those times, they take mica sheets, because mica can be cleaved just with the fingernail. And when the mica is cleaved, you have two wonderful clean surfaces. They have never seen the hair, and they put a liquid crystal inside these two mica sheets, and they observe the liquid crystal at the microscope. But by doing like this, positive and the negative charges were left on one side and the other side. And when they observed the liquid crystal, Grandjean saw that there was a motion in the liquid crystal. And he tried to reproduce the experiment between the electrodes of a generator, and he saw the same effect, so he concludes that it was the role of electricity. And I have given here an example from physical effects to the operation with the anatomy of a pixel. It is this, this kind of screen with black dots and a silver background. And pixel, it will be possible for you to try this screen without the requirement of a battery. I will show you how at the end. And where is the anatomy? It is it consists in two glass plates, and this guy placed the liquid crystal is sandwiched between these plates. A polarizer is put in this direction. The polarization, I will simply say that it is the direction of vibration of light. In the room here, the light is unpolarized. It means that the light vibrates in all directions. Here we put in a polarizer which transforms the unpolarized light incoming at the back of the pixel in a polarized light. Secondly, you put another linear polarizer, but in a direction perpendicular to the first one. It is for the other electrodes. And very important, the glass is conductive. It means that it has been covered with a very thin layer of a very thin metallic layer. And in fact, it is a capacitor here. And very important, last point for the fabrication, the internal surfaces have a very thin polymer film. It has been brushed in a given direction, and molecules of the liquid crystal, the first molecules close to the electrodes, put themselves in the grooves. And the direction of these grooves are the same direction than the polarizer. So it means that the pneumatic liquid crystal, which is put between these two glass substrates, with a wonderful agreement between the physical structure and the electromagnetic wave, the incoming light is polarized, linearly polarized first, and it follows the quarter of helix that is being created by the liquid crystal, and it is able to go out of the pixel. So this case corresponds to the silver aspect. So the anchoring is the first important property, but also the elasticity, because the chirality, in fact, of the pneumatic structure is not due to the molecules, the chirality of molecules. When I talk about chirality, I mean it's a mirror which is not the same that its image by mirror symmetry. And the quarter of the helix is given by the elasticity, because you have a continuous structure between the two opposite directions of molecules. Okay, it was the technical aspect of my talk, and I would mention also evidently the second state. When you apply an electric field, you untwist this quarter of helix because the molecules are aligned along the direction of the helix flow, a quarter of helix, because the helix does not exist, and it is blocked by the perpendicular polarizers. So the sensitivity to the field, important property. I have found one lady in this story, and not any lady, because it's Marie Friedel, the daughter of George Friedel. And Marie Friedel never graduated, but she had a passion for ancient languages. And one afternoon, George Friedel showed images like that of a nematic liquid crystal to his children. And Marie said to his father, "The Greek word for thread is nematos, that you should call your liquid crystal nematic." And so it means that the name of the liquid crystal found in the twisted nematic liquid crystal screen and in the labs, today the name is due to a very young lady. The name is quite rare. I know only one source, this one, in which the story is given, but maybe it has been given. There are maybe different facts. She was young, she was a girl, and she was not a scientist, and she never graduated. But she has given the name to the liquid crystal. And paradoxically, so okay, we are this state of matter is recognized by the scientific community. Friedel has given a very detailed paper. But liquid crystal research starts to decline. In the mid-1920s, policymakers regard liquid crystals as lab anomalies that will never find practical applications. Probably PhD students were fired. And Vorlander, I have given the name of Vorlander, himself wrote in 1924 that it could see no possible technical application for liquid crystal. It's a pity. So if researchers wish to receive fundings, they are encouraged to focus on politically correct topics. I mean, topics of Albert Einstein and Marie Curie, quantum mechanics. But valuable research activities continue by remaining rare and isolated in Europe mainly. But the revival from the end of the 20s begins in 1957 with a one-page long paper. In that time, scientists maybe wrote less papers, but they were very long. And two chemists from the University of Cincinnati in US, Glenn Brown and Wilfried Shaw, wrote this long paper to show that to their colleagues that the physical property and the chemical properties of this substance are very interesting. And the same Glenn Brown created the Liquid Crystal Institute at Kent State University in 1965. And the same year, the first conference was held at Kent State University, and the 40 scientists reviewed the current status of research on the topics. And in 1968, maybe probably the scientists and engineers were secretly present at the conference also, but they had started, in my opinion, the work in secret years before. And you know this press conference, I began my talk with that. And thus began the worldwide information display industry transformation. So the research was very intense from now. I would like to mention in 1977, for example, the discovery of the column phase made of disc-shaped molecules, because we know from this moment that molecules also may be like a disc, not only like a rod, by Chandrasekhar, And Chandrasekhar created the liquid crystal laboratory at the Raman Research Institute. And one of the outstanding schools of research in the field. And he's the author of the classic monograph called Simply Liquid Crystals. And he was very active in the creation in 1990 and the development of the International Liquid Crystal Society. In fact, the story of, maybe it's also the third main message, the story of liquid crystal displays, they are very famous for that, but it is a very little niche for very general question about the knowledge. For example, we don't know the relationship between the molecular chirality and the structural chirality of an assembly of these molecules. We know it for certain series of compounds, but not, we have no theory, generally speaking. Application, non-display application are very numerous. For example, tunable optical antennas, microfluidics, smart optical tags, camouflage, cosmetology, I've said, light shutters, and so on. But mainly, it is, I would say, the third main idea, the liquid crystal of life, because all the major macromolecules and biopolymers have a liquid crystal state. It is the case of DNA and chromatin. Chitin, chromatin is the compound of chromosomes. It's, as you know, DNA in itself. It's not really a macromolecule. Chitin, virus, collagen, and cellulose. The cholesteric structure, this one, thus, is a recurring design in animal and plant kingdoms. So DNA, chromatin. Collagen, it is the case of the human compact bone. You have a lot of, by chance, liquid crystal organization in your body. Not only the compact bone, but there is an image. I only given images for these cases. There are publications about the twisted structure. So it means that there are a lot of things to discover because I don't know why it is. Okay, fish case, a case of coelacanths here. Cellulose, it is case of these iridescent fruits, leaves also. A chitin, it is a case of crustaceans and insects. Arthropods represent 80% of the animal species. And maybe it will be discovered during the years, more and more cases of the twisted structure in the organization of these animals. And for example, in the cuticle of the lobsters, there is a hierarchical organization which reveals 7 structural levels. We start at the level of the basic monomer, I would say, the acetyl-D-glucosamine, which polymerized to give very long macromolecules of chitin. This is the second level. And then this, an assembly of these chitin molecules, so they have an orientational order, but a disorder for their position. And the proteins wrapped around them, and this constitute nanocrystal. And the level above, an assembly of these nanocrystals give nanofibril clusters, and these clusters organize themselves in very long, like very long tubes with a mean orientation, but a decisional disorder for the position. It is a liquid crystal. And this here, in that case, the elementary brick is not the molecule, but its object. And finally, this object twists in the well-known twisted structure. Here it is represented with layer, but it's for facility. And at the end, you have at 1 millimeter, the structure of the cuticle, the carapace of the lobster is twisted. But in fact, many insects, also I have maybe to make one comment, I have talked mainly about optical properties, but in that case, the twisted state offers mechanical strength to lobster, but also to the beetle I'm going to show, to the beetles. Because if you have no twist, when a crack arrives on the cuticle, it propagates on a smaller scale if you have a twist, by compare with the case with the absence of a twist. There are simulations about that. But many insects, in fact, all these insects, I'm not sure they have all a twisted state because I have not checked. But many insects present bumps, pits, pixels, right spots, patches. It is a collection in a museum, in a German museum here. But little is known on the physical properties of this geometric variation. And biological functions are unknown, still in debate, mainly between biologists and the physiologists, for example. And biomimetic materials are still waiting for, because these beetles have, for the beetles which have been studied, have very specific optical properties, so it should be good for optical components to mimic them. 30,000 species of beetles have been identified. 1 million of insects have been described, and maybe there is, it seems, 2 or 3 million, and all of them will have disappeared, according to a few authors, in a few decades, mainly less than one century, due to the destruction of their habitats, the pollution, the climate change. So we have to urge to mimic them. And here is a Buddhist temple. So you may ask, okay, it's a conference about liquid crystal or your holidays, maybe. In fact, no, it's always about liquid crystal, because it's Buddhist temple. There is a miniature sanctuary from the 7th century called Tamamushi no Zushi. And you can see a multitude of elytra of this beetle I have brought with me. You will be able to see it later. And this beetle is called Chrysichroa fujidissima, called Tamamushi in Japan. And Tamamushi hiro is a Japanese expression meaning Tamamushi color. It is used by Japanese people, it seems, to state to speak about a statement that is ambiguous and can be interpreted in various ways, because it's due to the fact that the color is not the same according to the direction, but it is the same object. And it is the case of this sanctuary, because it has a different color according to the position of the photograph. And it is used to qualify the language of politicians and bureaucrats. I don't know why. But it is an example which shows that the Bragg's law, it is the Bragg's law is the law in physics, which express the law for light reflection. But it means that this physical law has political and social application. Physics is everywhere. If you know physics, I have not to convince you. In fact, I have to confess now, because it was a good idea for you to stay there, because I have something to say, something of revolutionary, maybe. Liquid crystal display devices arrived on Earth millions of years ago, but maybe not really brought by aliens, but by beetles. Because 10 years ago, these beetles with beautiful colors have been discovered in Messel pits in Germany. It's very special condition for their preservation. And they have captured their colors. Chitin has disappeared for a long time, but the structure, due to the fossilization mechanism, I don't know it, has been preserved because you have the solidified structure, but the chitin, nanocrystal of chitin, have disappeared. So, but I've said liquid crystal display, but to display what? But probably a warning message, for example, don't eat me, I'm toxic, and it's sometimes a decoy. But also optical communication for social signaling, sexual selection, camouflage, to facilitate the escape, yes, because the fact that color is changing with the angle, it's disturbing the visual system of the bird. So it means it chances in more for the beetle to escape. But why the cholesteric structure has been conserved through evolution? Second question. I think it's an interesting question. If you agree with me, I would like to have a full seminar on this to give answers. Unfortunately, I've not. We can find literature only hypotheses. So I give you the hypotheses. So economy and eco-design, we will be probably inspired in our period to have an economy and eco-design principle. Because rather than chemically secreting a unique material with new optical indices and a new moduli of elasticity, to modify the color, you have just to modify the pitch. And the color is different, is the direction of the eclipse exchange. So it means that maybe Mother Nature has found that during the evolution, millions of years, when the warning messages of beetles, for example, or evolutions involves a modification of the structure and of the color, it is more simple to change the pitch than to secrete a new material every time, even if there are millions of years in between. So economy and eco-design principle. There is a broad range of solutions for colors and patterning from UV and infrared, because you can tune the pitch in synthetic material in the part of the spectrum you want. Tilted structure all of to you in more to change the color also with the angle. And I have to say that there is a rarity of circularly polarized light in nature. So it is probably an opportunity for the evolution, because it's a signal in more. And the eyes, you have not forgotten that the eyes and brains of insects are able to perceive polarized light, which we cannot. So here is the list of reference, because what I have said was not did not come from my mind. So I thank you for your attention.
You'll get the mic. Thank you. Thanks, Michelle. That's a very nice historical account of liquid crystals. So, you know, these screens and windows, there has to be a size limit, right? How big can you make them?
When I worked in a European program at this subject, mm-hmm. the maximum size, at the scale of my lab, my task was mm-hmm. limited to this size.
Okay.
But other the industrials that fabricate a large size mm-hmm. glass, mm-hmm. they fabricate up to 60 by 80 centimeter.
I see.
It is what prototype. So.
Okay. And the thickness would be?
The thickness depends on the pitch. Typically 15 or 20 micrometers.
Okay. So if it
but
becomes
you have not the same specification for these large windows that for example an optical components, you know, mm-hmm. where you have you have to have at small scale the same optical property and the thickness very regular also.
Okay, thank you.
So thank you, sir. So recently I am reading a book called Gene Machine. Gene Machine.
Gene Machine?
Gene Machine by Dr. Venki Ramakrishnan. He got the Nobel Prize for that. In that book, he talks about, he discovers the structure of ribosomes. He talks about crystallography and use of crystals. You got it. Just, I want to know what kind of crystals they use to deduce this thing, structure of ribosomes.
Unfortunately, I don't know this. I cannot answer to you, unfortunately, because I can imagine an answer, but I don't know precisely.
Yeah.
I prefer not to answer to you. I'm sorry, but maybe if you come, I will take your information later and I can send it to you.
Thank you. It
was exactly, what was the name of the, so it's a story of crystallization?
It's a story of, he discovers the ribosome structures.
Ah, ribosome, okay.
So he uses crystals, he obtains crystals.
I don't know the
X-ray and the diffraction.
Okay. So I personally don't know the use of crystal for ribosomes. I never heard. I wonder if the term is the author uses the term of crystals, like Lehmann discovers
the ribosome.
He has to explain. If he uses the term in common terms for the scientist, or if it is just an analogy, maybe it is an analogy.
No. Discover the ribosome structure. They use crystals.
Use
crystals.
Ah.
To diffract X-rays. You know.
Okay. I understand.
That's what.
Okay. I cannot say more.
Thank you.
Yeah, if you have a question, you can raise your hand.
Maybe more of a historical question, but you mentioned kind of the hesitancy to accept liquid crystals because they stood outside the three other states of matter. Were there other discoveries of other states that kind of helped this acceptance along around this time in the early 19th century, the early 20th century?
But you have what we call the fourth state of matter, the plasma state. I have to say that a few people, maybe not recently, but called the liquid crystal fourth state of matter. But as I have explained, numbering the states of matter is somewhere crazy. But I think that, yes, new states of matter have been recognized in the gaseous state. But my feeling is that there are some subtleties in that case to talk about new states of matter, because in fact it's some particular organization of matter, I would say, in the gaseous state. I would say also that in the structure of water is a complicated structure, and there are a lot of debate. It is a simple liquid, but the discussion about the structure of in water, according at short length almost, is active. But I cannot say more. Thank you.
Yeah. So between a rod-like molecule and disc-like molecule, which one is better for making display and why?
In my opinion, for example, if you want if you are thinking about liquid crystal display, it's sure that this is elongated molecules. If I think about application, I don't know very well this field, but application of disc-shaped molecules and discotic phases It was a diode emitting light with specific molecules, but also very interesting the concept of an electrical wire with the core will be the conductive part, and how the all around this core, so it builds it's a pile of disks, it is the isolation, the isolators. But I have to say that in conference, this field is actually not much active. It doesn't mean that it is not interesting, but I have no clear view. But for the displays like this, it's rod-like molecules.
Yes, sir, I had a question. So how does forces and chaos like Brownian motion and all fit into this? Like how do you deal with chaos and disorder in a like a liquid crystal or something? It's more disorganized than a solid crystal, right?
Okay. Liquid crystal, so the description of liquid crystal is just a description of a mixed order. It's a state of matter between order and disorder. And full stop, I would say. It can be completely solid, like a glass, a cross-linked polymer, or a composite material, and or a gel, a physical or chemical gel. But the definition of a liquid crystal not be associated to its fluid state. I don't know if I answer to your question, but maybe I not understood. It is the answer for your question? What I have said, it is the answer to your question? Or you said something of different?
So I just wanted to know, like, isn't the disorder more in a liquid crystal compared to a solid crystal, like Brownian motion or like...
You have Brownian motion in both cases, but in crystal they are very, very, very slow. There are more, Brownian motion. And even when you look at, for example, a nematic liquid crystal, without any electric field, you need even, it depends on the camera, but you see some very slight effects of brightening domains, and it's due to the fact that the molecule never cease to diffuse in your slab of liquid crystal between glass plates. So a lot of Brownian motion in liquid, almost in fact, less the liquid crystal phase is ordered, and it is the case, the nematic phase is the less ordered phase. But you can also encounter smectic liquid crystal, quite ordered, in this liquid, and even there are different classes of smectics, and you will find some authors, maybe in all literature, they talked about quasi-crystalline smectic liquid crystal. So it's very complicated. It means that, okay, they are highly organized, but if we have a positional disorder in what direction of the space, you can talk about liquid crystals, even if the substance is very hard.
Thank you, sir.
Yeah, so I have one question, Professor Mito. So I believe LCD screens are now being replaced by LED screens, at least in phones. I mean, is there some energy advantage that LEDs have over LCD, or is that the color? What's the reason behind this trend?
In fact, it is for two different applications, because the cholesteric liquid crystal have a very slow response time to electric field. It is the reason why at the end of the 60s, when people start to work on liquid crystal, they have found that cholesteric liquid crystal cannot react very quickly, insufficiently, to display a moving image and a movie. And for that reason, they have abandoned cholesteric liquid crystal for this application. Research continue, but much of efforts and budget were devoted to nematics. And the response time typically for cholesterics is 1 or 2 seconds. And it's sufficient for the example of application for the panel board, because you have just an information to show, or if you write on a blackboard and so on. So in fact, it's due to the fields of application are different, but maybe some researcher will find one day, for example, the way to actuate liquid crystal in a certain way, the electronic. I don't know, there are research on it. But they will find ways to activate with a good response time cholesteric system. But the answer is that different fields of application. And I would say the fact to work without polarizer for the helix, because in this display, there is no polarizer. There is transparent glass and the liquid crystal. Here you have, between you and the glass, a polarizer, and it absorbs 50% of the ambient light.
Can I just ask a follow-up there? So I think the price is also a problem, right? Because liquid crystals are way more expensive than semiconductor diodes.
For the application of
LED versus LCs, liquid crystals, I think diodes are also way cheaper, right?
I don't know exactly. Maybe,
okay.
Maybe.
Okay.
I have no clear answer about it. Is what you have found?
No, I mean, it was just an impression. I'm not citing any sources. Maybe I'm wrong, but I'm just asking.
For the application of a diode?
I think the question was about LEDs versus LCs, right?
I don't know the price and does the difficulty to produce. For example, you talk about discotic molecules, probably.
Right.
And I don't know exactly. It's due to this, because the final price, you know, this kind of screen at the beginning of 70s to have an electronic clock was a very nice gift, because it was very expensive. And years after, it was just a few rupees.
Right. Okay. Thank you.
Thank you, Professor. So, if there are no more questions, then let's thank the speaker, and I'll ask Rukmini ma'am to...
Okay, thank you.
So, thank you, Professor Mitov. Thank you for the wonderful talk. Thank you for attending. We have coffee outside, so please have some coffee. And you can also try out a few exhibits here, which Professor Mitov has brought. Feel free to experiment and observe. Thanks.